Dharma, incomparably profound and exquisite, is rarely met with even in hundreds of thousands of millions of kalpas. We now can see it, hear it, accept and hold it. May we realize the true mind of the Tathagata. Today is the first day of this 7-day sesshin here in northern New Jersey in March 2018. It's warmed up a little bit. It's 40 degrees now, which is kind of terrific, but apparently there's still another storm coming in. And I'd like to start by speaking about the fundamental practice that we do here at Turtleback Zendo, and also at Hidden Valley Zen Center, and also at Mountain Gate. And this is called Susokan. It's a traditional Rinzai Japanese fundamental practice, and it's an incredible effective practice. It can take us extremely deep. There's some sense that it is actually the same practice that the Buddha himself was doing. And I know that one of my Dharma sisters at the Rochester Zen Center misunderstood the instructions to, quote, follow her breath, close quote, and thought that she was also to extend it as well, and within that very sesshin had a deep Kensho experience. There's a big difference between extending the out-breath, assuming you're truly experiencing the full dimensions of this experience, and just following the breath. Because in extending the out-breath, what happens is as you push the breath farther out than you ordinarily would, and the way you do it, basically, is to breathe out naturally, and then when you get to the bottom of that breath where you'd automatically breathe right back in again, instead you bring the breath further out. And how far you bring it out depends on your lung capacity. The idea is to empty your lungs completely, not to hang out at the bottom, but to, as soon as they are fully emptied, let your breath naturally come in however fast it wants to come in. And a key in this is that you're truly becoming one with the experience of the out-breath. You're not thinking about something, you're not trying to get it out to a particular level, like my then 16-year-old grandson thought was important when he came to Mountain Gate and stayed for a couple of weeks, and very, very much was impressed by some of the other folks who were staying there in Zen training, and asked to be taught how to do Susokan. He actually, turns out, had one eye on the clock as he was breathing out, and extended it as far as he could, and kept trying to best that measure. But even in spite of that, he got quite deep and quite let go. And eventually, when he joined the Navy and was in the Middle East, I emailed him and said, do you remember that extended breath practice that I taught you? And if you are in any kind of stress, or even if you just simply want to be able to be fully present, then go ahead and do that for however long it's possible to do. And when he came back from that 9-month tour of duty, out there in the midst of the battle, really, in a very vulnerable position, he was on a very tiny, very slow moving boat that was pulling sea mines out of the sea to make the area more safe. And as such, he was quite a sitting duck for any boat that was faster. And as it turns out, there had already been a couple of attacks on a French minesweeper and also on a British minesweeper. And the French minesweeper attack resulted in at least two of the mine men being killed. And the British attack resulted in the imprisonment of the entire crew for many, many months before finally they were extricated through some form of diplomatic channel. So it was a dangerous and relatively stressful job, ongoing for many, many months. And if you've ever been in the Navy, it's not 8-hour days, it's 16-hour days. You're on duty 16 hours at a stretch. And then if you also have a night watch duty, you have 20 minutes between the end of your 16 hours and when you have to go on watch for the next 4 hours and stay utterly wide awake to keep the whole boat safe. Then what Duncan did was to take those 20 minutes, and as he told me, he went to the quietest possible place in the boat, which was not really very quiet, and he did the extended out-breath for those 20 minutes. And when he came back from that tour of duty, he was so grounded and so aware, as if he'd been practicing Zen for quite some time, and indeed he had been. So this is one example of, two examples when you also talk about my Dharma sister's example of how powerful this breath practice can be. The power comes as a result of the extension of the out-breath, because in extending that out-breath, we have to pay attention more readily than we would just paying attention. It forces us to a deeper level of attention, and in order for that to happen, we simply have to let go other involvements. And it is training our brain to let go, which is, of course, a fundamental aspect of spiritual practice, to let go our yada yada, our constant rotating of thoughts, ideas, assumptions that keep us assuming that we are a distinct, discrete, permanent individual, because we're not. And I'd like to share with you a little bit from this book, Ordinary Magic, that was put together by John Wellwood. He's both a clinical psychologist and a longtime Zen practitioner. He started doing spiritual practice when he was in college, at the same time he was studying to become a clinical psychologist. And he has come up with some important books regarding spiritual practice, in one of which he speaks to the something that people have chronically done over the ages, certainly in the West, and that is avoid their psychological issues through sort of squashing them with the Zen practice, which is anything but effective. We may know people who have been practicing meditation for many, many years, decades even, who have even been working on subsequent koans for a long time, and yet their daily life is still fraught with, well, let's just say, greed, anger, and delusion. It seems they have not moved out of their habitual patterns of behavior, despite the levels that they appear to have achieved in their spiritual practice. And that is because they have ignored, squashed, turned their backs on, shoved under the carpet any issues that came to light as they were doing their practice. And this is, as we said in the opening talk, a very important aspect of practice, that we don't ignore our stuff. And in fact, when it comes up, there is the prime time to work on it. May not come up if we stuff it under the carpet, shove it under the zafu. Then it may not come up again ever, but we'll still be pulling our strings and defining our behavior. We'll find ourselves reacting from that stance, from that habit pattern, and that is not what spiritual practice is about. What is it about? It is about seeing where we're caught and working to let it go, because as we go deeper in our practice, we encounter places where we have been caught in habit patterns of dysfunction through whatever conditioning we've experienced. If we've been traumatized, there's even more intense conditioning that's gone on. And in order to truly be free, we cannot ignore it. We have to work with it. If it's truly intense, then it's important, vital really, to work with a therapist who is skilled in working with that kind of an issue and has some background, an important background. This is really an important aspect of anyone who does do psychotherapy, that they have the experience of a meditation practice, ideally a Zen meditation practice. Because if not, and this has happened with some people who've been at Mountain Gate, if you get a therapist who hasn't got that kind of a background, as well as their psychological training, they can completely misinterpret Zen practice and cause all kinds of problems with a person's Zen practice in the guise, or I don't think they're ill-meaning, but in the effort to free them from whatever else is going on with them psychologically. But even if it's not to the level of something we need to work with someone professionally about, we all have stuff. We all have stuff. We all have habit patterns that were created as a result of responses or reactions to situations we've encountered as we grew up. And it's important to sort of own those experiences, allow ourselves to feel remorse, regret that we behaved in these ways that we begin to see we have done. And that has a tremendous amount of positive power in helping us let go the habit pattern that is causing that sort of greed, anger, and delusion, and become free of it. Because the freedom that we can experience through our deep Zen practice is such that there's nothing sticky in us. That's the only way we can experience that level of freedom. There was, for a long time, in the Rochester Zen Center's archives, a writing that appeared in a very, very early Zen book, which is the ongoing journal of the Rochester Zen Center, written by a woman whose pseudonym was Carol. Eventually I realized who it was, but it doesn't matter who it was, only that it really did happen. This was a person who wrote about a particular sesshin that she had to virtually nail herself to the mat to keep herself from running out of the zendo. Such was whatever was going on with her. There was some deep fear in her that was making her want to flee. And she didn't flee. She hung in there. And she hung in there. And it was very difficult because all kinds of things came up to her. And these were not really what we would term makyo, although in a sense anything that interferes with our practice is makyo. These were memories of experiences she'd had and the feelings around them. And eventually, she reached the end of sesshin, and in that sesshin, because of all the hard work she had been doing, both before the sesshin, she'd been to many sesshin, she had a kensho experience, and this is what she wrote about it. She said, "This practice is truly bodhisattvic. First, it shows you where you're caught, and then it sets you free." The thing is, we would all love to jump over the seeing where we're caught part and just get to the freedom part, but we can't do it without going through the muck, as a Dharma friend of mine who's also a Zen teacher in a different lineage said. To allow ourselves to be brave and open up to whatever comes up for us, and to let ourselves experience it in our bodies. We're talking about experiencing the energy that comes up, not the story. The stories can't do it. We have to experience the energy that's been locked in our body that really is the habit pattern in order to become free of it. And that means facing it squarely, owning it, feeling the regret, the remorse, feeling it until it dissolves. And then something quite amazing can happen. We honestly can become more free of whatever that was. It may take two or three or four different levels of experiencing that habit pattern and its results for that truly to take place to a point where it simply doesn't come up again. But it is an amazing, effective practice. And, you know, there was, when Zen was beginning to get more well known in America, there were people who said that just as when it entered China, it sort of became amalgamated with Confucianism and Taoism, particularly Taoism, that in America it was going to become amalgamated with psychology. And that seems to have been the case. There's a very wide, fuzzy line between Zen practice and psychological work. It overlaps both. And in a sense, both are important for us truly to be free. Psychology, just straight psychological work, can take us to a certain level, not as deep as Zen practice can. But Zen practice can only take us deeply enough if we also are able to clear out the psychological stuff. So working in tandem, they're a dynamite duo. And the Susokan, the extended out breath, brings us quickly face to face with where we're caught. And if we then allow ourselves to tune into the bodily experience of that, miracles can happen. I'd like to share now with you from this book, Ordinary Magic, something of the writing of Krishnamurti. Some of you were around the Rochester Zen Center long enough, you may have actually known Tony Packer, who was the first person that was authorized to teach by Roshi Keplo, and was basically set in charge of the Rochester Zen Center while Keplo Roshi went to Mexico for a year sabbatical to write a book. And it was cut short by a couple of events. One is that a bunch of us senior people had gone out to New Mexico to build a retreat place for Keplo Roshi to live out his last years in. At that point, he was not even 70, I don't think. But he was looking at possibility of turning Rochester over to Tony and just working with senior students out in New Mexico. He'd always wanted a country place. Well, both plans were not really meant to be. And Tony left the Rochester Zen Center because, as she put it, she really didn't feel she was Buddhist. And in the bylaws, the Rochester Zen Center state that anyone who is teaching at the Rochester Zen Center has to be a Buddhist. Her feeling was much more in line with the way of teaching of him, of Krishnamurti. And so she left and started her own center and was teaching in that way. But we have a lot to be inspired by Krishnamurti, who was an East Indian man, discovered as a very young man, I think he was only 14 or 15 years old at the most, by the Theosophists, who were a 19th century group of spiritual practitioners. And they had in mind that this young man had the makings of becoming a world spiritual leader. He eventually opted out of that role, which is to his credit. He was not interested in fame or importance, and ended up leading a group, well, leading groups all over the world, really, and finally dying in Ojai, California, at a relatively ripe old age. And he was clearly deeply realized. And this is from a chapter in this book called Everyday Meditation. It is strange, the desire to show off or to be somebody. It seems so impossibly difficult to be simple, to be what you are and not to pretend. To be what you are is in itself very arduous. You can always pretend, put on a mask, but to be what you are is an extremely complex affair because you're always changing. You're never the same, and each moment reveals a new facet, a new depth, a new surface. You can't be all this at one moment, for each moment brings its own change. So, if you're at all intelligent, you give up being anything. You think you're very sensitive, and an incident, a fleeting thought, shows that you're not. You think you're clever, well-read, artistic, moral, but turn around the corner, you find you're none of these things, but that you're deeply ambitious, envious, insufficient, brutal, and anxious. You're all these things turn by turn, and you want something to be continuous, permanent, of course only that which is profitable and pleasurable. So you run after that, and all the many other things, you know, all the many other yous are clamoring to have their way, to have their fulfillment, and so you become a battlefield. And generally, ambition, with all its pleasures and pain, is gaining with envy and fear. So to be what you are is an extremely arduous affair. If you are at all awake, you know all these things and the sorrow of it all. So you drown yourself in your work, in your belief, in your fantastic ideals and meditations. By then, you've become old and ready for the grave, if you're not already dead inwardly, to put away all these things, with their contradictions and increasing sorrow, and be nothing is the most natural and intelligent thing to do. But before you can be nothing, you must have unearthed all these hidden things, exposing them and so understanding them. To understand these hidden urges and compulsions, you will have to be aware of them without choice, as with death. Then, in the pure act of seeing, and this is vital, in the pure act of seeing, they will wither away, and you will be without sorrow, and so be as nothing. To be as nothing is not a negative state. The very denial of everything you have been is the most positive action. I'm not sure I'd say the very denial of everything that you have been. The very letting go of everything you think you've been is the most positive state. The freedom that one experiences when one has had a deep Kensho experience is so free because suddenly we don't have to be somebody. We don't have to maintain an image that has to be defended, that gets embarrassed, that gets angry when it's denied. We can be who we truly are, which is an innately compassionate, wise being. It's been through lots of experiences in life, some of them pleasant, some of them painful. Some of them exciting, some of them boring, but all of them shifting and temporary. Some of them, of course, have left their mark, and we work with those as they come up. And little by little, we become totally free. It's not a fast process. It's not an easy process, but it is incredibly worth it. And we have the tools with which to effect it right here in our own grasp. And there's nothing except our own thoughts, ideas, assumptions that can make it less effective. So we've gotten off to a good start. We can take it all the way down to the very bottom of our being and free ourselves in incomparable ways. All it takes is a willingness to dive in and to stay diving deep within to uncover the incredibleness of who you really are. So I thank you for listening. We'll stop now and recite the four vows.